one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have one item tonight. It's rental registration update and inspection discussion, and Brad Clausen will lead the discussion.
Thank you, Mayor, Commissioners. It's our pleasure to be here this evening to give you an update on our rental, our residential rental registration program. Start with a little background on the program. I think probably several of you or all of you probably recall this program was adopted almost exactly 2 years ago. The topic has been discussed, again, as you're all probably well aware, many times in the past, going back many years. The most recent iteration was our current registration program, and as I said, that was passed on March 7th, 2017. Became effective on March 12th, 2017, and registrations began on April 10th, 2017. If you're so inclined and would like to look at the actual ordinance language, it's in Chapter 8, Article 19 of our Code of Ordinances. So we'll begin with what's covered under this particular current program. And really what's covered is fairly simple. It's residential rental dwelling units. That does include fraternities and sororities, but it does not include owner-occupied units. It does not include transient lodging, hotels, motels, other types of things that may be licensed at a state level. Care facilities, treatment homes, group homes, those are all licensed through the state, and consequently they're not covered under our residential rental registration program. The ordinance actually requires, the requirements of the ordinance are fairly simple. It's not a long ordinance. If you've actually read it or look through it in the Code of Ordinances, it's only a few pages, and the requirements are fairly simple. The owners, when the program was passed, the owners of residential rental dwelling units had until July 1st, 2017 to register their units or prior to first occupancy. So if we had units that were under construction at that time and weren't done until after that date, they were just required to register prior to occupancy. The registration required some simple information, an owner's name and contact information. It required the property identification, so the address of the property, number of dwelling units within those structures. It required, if the owner lived outside of a 60-mile radius of Manhattan, it required a local agent for the property. We did have actually several owners who are local owners that went ahead and registered their local agents anyway, even though they didn't have to, because I assume they wanted their agents to receive the information that we sent out as part of that program. So we have more agents registered really than are required, but that's a good thing from our point of view. The agent, we had some I think maybe a little misunderstanding up front that the required agent does not need to be a paid agent. So we have people who have named family members who live in town as their local agent, neighbors, you know, things like that that allow us, somebody that's local, to be a local point of contact for that property. It allows us to be able to facilitate contact with the owner when we need to through that local person. And that local agent also receives courtesy copies anytime we send code violation notices out on a property. So if we recognize a code violation on a property and that property is registered in our registration program, the registered agent will receive an email courtesy copy of that code notice. And that's proved to be a good, I think, a good thing for us as well. Sometimes it gets those violations taken care of a little bit sooner. The ordinance did not require a fee to register. I know there was discussion when that ordinance was passed about whether or not to include a fee, but in the end, no fee was required. and it's a one-time only registration. So once you register, you don't come back annually and renew. The only time you need to do something is if your information changes. So if the owner changes addresses, emails, phone numbers, if they buy properties, sell properties, simple for them just to log back into the system using their login info and update their information, and they're done. So once somebody's registered, unless something changes, they're really pretty much done with what they need to do.
So Brad?
Yes.
Right here. How would you know if they don't have, if you're not checking on them and they only, it was a one-time deal, how do you know if any changes have been made?
We actually, Commissioner, we don't know with each and every one of them. I will tell you, though, that we do have a lot of people that do come back and update information. In a future slide, when I get to the numbers of our registered units, that info changes daily, almost hourly sometimes. If I look at that database in the morning, there's almost always submitted information on there from the previous day, or someone in the evening submitted info, and many times now it's updates to their information. So we are getting that. Are we getting all of it? Probably not. It's probably not much different than a lot of other licensing or registration things where, you know, with our general contractors licenses, for instance, I'll use that. You know, they're supposed to let us know if they change their address or something, so that when we send license renewals out, we can do that. They're pretty good about that, but once in a while somebody just forgets to do it. So if we run across a property and it's not updated, we'll contact that person and ask them to make sure they update their property. So we, in answer to your question, Commissioner, we don't know, but we do see people making those changes, so that's a good thing. Yeah. The program does not require any inspections. Wanted to make that clear. I think some people thought there was some inspection requirement with the program, even though we do inspections. I'll get to that in a minute. The program itself does not require that. We tried to make it as simple as we could to register so that people could do that fairly simply. If you go to our website, you can log in with a user ID and a PIN. You simply have to call our office and we'll supply the owners with their login info. Once they log in, they just input their information, submit it, and they're done. So it's pretty simple. Or if you're not somebody who likes to do that stuff online, you can certainly come into our office and do it there. It's not a big deal. We've had quite a few people that have come in and registered just in person with us. So we've tried to make it as easy as we can for owners to get that accomplished. Of course, we're always constructing new rental units, so we address those during the construction of the units and make sure that the property owners understand that before we issue them a certificate of occupancy, that they have to register their rental units. So anytime you see a new apartment building being constructed, we're in contact with the owners to make sure that they get that accomplished prior to the first occupancy of that building. And of course, we do have non-registered properties, and we run across those somewhat routinely. We identify those usually when our inspectors are out doing inspections on other types of things. So they may be out looking at a complaint on a trash issue or a mowing notice or something. Usually if we notice that the owner's address is different than the address of the property, we'll make the assumption that's probably a rental. And if it's not listed in our rental registration database, then we send the owner of that property a notice and ask them to either register the property or to submit evidence to us as to why it's not a rental unit. And that happens sometimes as well. Sometimes we'll send those notices out and the owners will call or email or mail us back and say, hey, it's vacant, I'm just trying to sell it, I'm not renting it, that's fine, I have my daughter or son living there, and I'm not renting it, they're just going to school and living there. So sometimes it's those type of things, and that's good. We're good with that. So most of the other times, though, we send those notices out. The owners just may not have known they needed to register, so we get them set up, they register, and all's good, and we're on to the next one. There are potential penalties, though, for not registering. So if we have someone, and it's fortunately not happened, it's happened once so far, that we've actually had to go to court with someone who just simply wouldn't register their property. But the ordinance does set up a penalty for not registering your properties. Here's the numbers I talked about currently, and I did this slideshow last week, so I looked this morning, I think we're now over 13,200 actually. That's, as I said, that number just fluctuates daily. It continues to change. But we're in that 13,200 range, 1,680 plus owners now. It's not on the slide, but I think we have about 350 registered agents of properties also on there now. Keeping in mind that one agent may manage several properties, so the number of agents is quite a bit smaller, but that's part of the reason why. Those 13,200 units are contained within about 4,600 addresses, so 4,600 different structures. Since July 1st of 2017, we've sent out, and that number again is probably slightly higher now since last week, but we've sent out 894 registration violation letters. But of those, we've only had to take one person to a legal action for not registering their property. So normally when we send those, as I said, compliance is attained and the units are registered. The ordinance also allows us to institute an education program, which we have done, and we think that's one of the important parts of this registration program, is that we're able to, or better able to, educate landlords, tenants, and agents on code requirements, all kinds of things. You see at the bottom of the slide there, some of the, we use the email list to send out notifications or just reminders. So here pretty soon we'll probably send another one out that it's, remember, it's time to start looking at mowing your yard again. We sent one out last winter when it was snow season and shoveling your sidewalks. It was particularly helpful, I think, during Fake Patty's Day, in that we sent emails to all of our registered agents and owners and asked them to pass along some information to their tenants regarding nuisance ordinances and rooftop parties and things like that. And I believe that's been a positive impact of this program, that we've been able to distribute that better. So we've done several dedicated educational events already. Also, we've done 10 to date. The next one is scheduled for a couple of weeks as part of the HUD Fair Housing Seminar. So I would encourage you, if you are thinking about coming to that, it's always good info at that seminar. So that'll be our next one. A couple of those educational events that we've done were what we termed Meet the Inspector. I know Commissioner Butler came to one of those, and I hope found it interesting and informative. It was an effort to try and introduce our inspection staff to owners, managers, that kind of thing, and then to just answer questions that the owners and managers had. And we did that twice now, and it's been, I think, very successful both times. So we're looking at doing a third one of those sometime here, coming up probably in the early summer sometime. So that'll be our next one after the April 18th presentation. Just some other benefits of this current program. Again, it gives us current contact info for property owners and managers. I think, and I've mentioned this before, but it's worth repeating, I think the ability to email courtesy copies of code violations to the managers is helpful. Just knowing who manages properties is helpful in many cases, because we can institute communication in that way if we need to. the email feature of that's excellent. Distribution of our upcoming educational sessions and other topics of interest. Creation of a registration map that we've done now, so you can go to the city's website, and I hope all of you have taken a look at that. We have all of the registered properties shown on the map. You can actually click on the properties and it will bring up the address and the registered owner's name. And then we also have, in conjunction with that, a map of code violations on various properties around town. So it's a separate map, but again, you can click on a property and find what the entire history of code has been on that particular property. So the hope there was that perhaps some of those type of tools may have been useful for tenants, maybe in selecting rental properties if they wanted to do some research on those. So that's really the overview of our current registration program, what's required, and what we're doing currently. The last few slides really are just some additional information that I wanted to share with you. As I said earlier, inspections are not currently required by the registration program. However, we do inspections similar to what we've done, with the exception of 2011 when we had a mandatory inspection program. In my experience, this is really how we've done inspections over the last many years, with that one exception, and that is through tenant requests or tenant complaints. You see, that's the vast majority of the inspections we do currently. We do have a few owners that still volunteer units for us to go in occasionally. And then we have outside entities that sometimes refer units to us. Maybe Fort Riley Off Post Housing that's seen something particularly egregious that they think we might ought to look into. Maybe other local agencies. We've had a few come to us through Child and Adult Protective Services that have referred conditions in units to us. So those are typically how we do our full interior and exterior inspections now. You see there, we over the last 7 years, and I use 7 years because that's the length of time since the mandatory inspection ceased, we're averaging right around 100 units a year. So that's about on par historically with what we've done over time. You see, I put the total number of units we've inspected, not including those mandatory ones, since 98. That average is a little higher. It's about 140 a year. That's mostly because in the 90s, we had the City Commission really urged owners, in lieu of doing a mandatory inspection program, to have their units voluntarily inspected. So we had a couple of year span where we had several hundred voluntary inspections, and then that sort of tailed off again sometime in the early 2000s. But that number stays pretty consistent through time, it seems like. Over that amount of time, we've had to obtain two administrative warrants to gain entry into properties when we were fairly sure we had good evidence that there were some fairly serious code violations in properties, and the occupants would not allow us entry. We were successful both times that we attempted to obtain those warrants. We did start a third warrant process, but the tenant, the occupant of the structure, went ahead and allowed us entry as we were in the process of doing that, so we didn't have to follow through with that one. So fortunately, we haven't had to go through that process very often in the past, but it's there if we need to, and if we use it sparingly when we feel it's warranted. So the inspection standards that we use when we do our current inspections are out of the International Property Maintenance Code. I've brought my copy of it. You can see it's a fairly minimal set of standards. It's applicable to all existing structures in the city. It contains enforcement regulations for those inspections. It contains interior and exterior requirements just generally for the condition of the structures. Light ventilation requirements, occupancy requirements, electrical, plumbing, HVAC, fire safety, all contained in a minimal form in this code. You will get to hear about that again here in a few months. Our codes are due to be updated again here in June of this year. So every 3 years we update those. So we'll be back to you here again in June with some code updates to all of our codes. And then finally, just some other inspections that our staff conducts. And I know that, again, many of you are probably well aware of this, but we do exterior inspections. If we get a complaint, for instance, on a structure, maybe a neighborhood's got a particular problem structure and they want to let us know about it, we'll go do an exterior inspection of it and address any obvious code violations that are on the exterior of those properties. We do those, about 160 of those annually. All of our nuisance inspections, tall grass, weeds, junk cars, we do between 3,000 and 4,000 of those annually. We try to be as proactive as we can on those so that people don't have to complain to us, but we still get some complaints on those annually, but I don't think many people probably realize how many of those we actually do on an annual basis. Parking in the front yards, we do several of those, especially when school starts in the fall, and we typically have to re-educate people not to park on the grass in your front yard. Over occupancy, you'll see there, that's a fairly small number, about 10, maybe one a month or so. Those come to us typically maybe from neighborhood complaints that, again, may have a property where they've noticed a whole bunch of cars parking and they're pretty sure there's more than the four unrelated tenants living there. So those are very time consuming for us to follow up on. We've got to do an investigation and find out who's living there, and we process that if we have evidence to our legal staff, and then they take it from there. So that's not a big number, but it's a fairly time-consuming process. Sign inspections we do on signs that are installed in the city. Then some other things, construction inspections, that varies from year to year, but generally in the 4,000 to 5,000 inspections a year on construction in the city. Fire inspections, a lot of required state and local occupancies have required inspections for fire safety requirements, so we do around 2,000 of those a year. So that just kind of gives you an overview of generally the numbers and types of inspections that our staff does. It's not on the slide, but we also issue licenses to our contractors. We have around 1,100 licensed contractors here in Manhattan, and we do educational classes for them as well, because they have to have CEUs to renew their licenses, so we try to provide as many of those as we can locally. So that's, in a nutshell, kind of an overview of our inspections and some other things that we do. That's the end of my presentation. I'd be glad to answer any questions that you all may have.
Just wanted to just clarify, now KSU with dormitories and various housing facilities, mm-hmm. We don't do anything with those.
No, our inspections typically are within the city limits outside of state property.
Brad, why don't you elaborate on the exceptions? So K-State is an exception. What are the others?
As far as residential inspections, Commissioner? If somebody requests an inspection and it's not a state property or federal property, we'll typically do it. So, there's no real exemptions outside of this registration program,
okay,
which has exemptions for registering. As I said, that's usually transient type occupancies and care facilities and things like that. But if somebody wants us to do an inspection on a property and they're the owner or legal occupant, we'll do the inspection for them. So
what about mobile homes?
We do that, yes. Mobile homes are
do they have to register in the program?
Yes, if they're rentals, they do, and they're not owner occupied, they register in the program. So our mobile home parks, we have several registered rental units within those parks.
What do you mean by construction? You said there's 4,000 to 5,000 construction.
Construction inspections, Commissioner. That would be inspections we do as something is being built.
So any kind of
construction. So
whether it's apartments, commercial,
yes,
residential.
You name it. It's somebody adding a deck on the back of their house. That's construction
any
inspection.
Any renovations, okay.
So anytime we issue a building permit or an electrical permit, even things like if you're replacing the electric service on the back of your house, we issue a permit and come do an inspection on it. Power company won't connect it until we do that. So it ranges anywhere from pretty small construction projects up to, you know, big, large commercial size projects.
So I just wanted to note, if a property owner wanted to add something else, like another unit to mm-hmm. their house, for rental, you would know about that.
Oh, absolutely. We'd issue a building permit. We do a plan review of the plans before we even issue a permit. Then we'd issue the permit and do the series of construction inspections as it's being built or added on to.
So yeah. when they're adding on and you go in to do that, do you check out the rest of the house?
We don't just go through the rest of the building, no. I mean, if we notice something, you know, we're not there to do an inspection of the existing property. We're there to look at a specific part of the construction. So, you know, now that being said, if there's something that's glaringly obvious as we're walking to that part of the structure, you know, it's we feel like we need to address that type of thing. But we're not there to just walk around the rest of the building and do an inspection otherwise, unless it's something related to the construction itself.
Thank you.
I'm sure this is going to come up, so we might just say a few words about the contrast between what we do and maybe what Lawrence, Kansas, is currently doing.
Sure, Commissioner. There are a few other cities in the state, actually there's more than a few, that have some kind of either registration or licensing and exterior inspections only. Lawrence and Wyandotte County are really the only two that are still doing interior inspections that I'm aware of. Now, I'm not saying there aren't others, but the ones that I know of are those two. Hutchinson was doing interior inspections, but they have since gone to exterior only. I talked to them just yesterday and they updated me on that. Their program actually is slated by ordinance to sunset at the end of this year. They did that on purpose because they wanted a date certain where they could review the program and either renew it or not, depending on the wishes of their commission. Lawrence, though, is really the one that does interior inspections. They do 10% of an owner's portfolio every 3 years. So if you own 100 units, they do 10 of them. The max is 15, though. So I use the new Lynx project out here. There's over 600 units under one owner out there. They would not do 60 of those. They do 15. It's either 10% or a max of 15. They have an incentive within their program. If you have 5 or less violations during your inspection, you can stretch out your next inspection date to a later date down the road. So they really don't do 10%. They probably do somewhat less than that after you take the incentives and the big property owners that they only do 15 of out of the equation. They have the, of course, since the state statute changed and there's the requirement now that the occupants have to give permission for them to enter, they told me that they have the owners of the properties facilitate that permission from the tenant and have the tenant sign the permission forms. They have had a few occasions where they've not been able to gain entry, and honestly, what they do a couple of things. They've obtained a few warrants, administrative warrants, to gain entry. When I asked how many a few was, I was told less than 5. I asked, have you ever been turned down for a warrant? And he said, no, they have not. The ones they've attempted to get, they've been successful in. But sometimes if an owner has a large portfolio and somebody's refusing them entry, some of the times I think what they'll do is just move to a different unit since they're not looking at all of the units in that particular complex. So I think it's just easier for them to do it that way sometimes than it is not. So does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think one of the other pieces is that the Kansas statute says that it can't be periodic, can't be based on a periodic.
Well, Katie can help me out here if I'm wrong, but I think it can be periodic if the tenant gives consent to the inspection. Is that correct, Katie? Yeah.
So, and periodic essentially means some kind of cycle. So what I'm interested in is, in Lawrence, for example, I don't know if you know this, but how do they select the properties?
The 10%, you mean?
Right.
I think they try to work with the owners and do properties that maybe are vacant at the time. That's always helpful because then you don't have to worry about getting the, you know, the tenant's consent for that. They of course are going to try to not do the same 10% every time. So if they do, the owner selects 10% up front for them to do, then they'll try to do a different batch next time and then so on. You know, owners that only own maybe one or two units, they're going to get the same one inspected every time, though, for the small owners. So. Yeah.
And the is there an administrative charge for that?
They have a license fee for the program. Now, I can't tell you, I'm sorry, Mayor, off the top of my head, I'm not sure what their fee is, but I know they have a fee for their program, so.
Don't quote me on this, but I think it's $50 per unit and no more than $500. Altogether. I could be wrong about that though, but it's somewhere around there. I have a question, and it is written in their ordinance that they will favor vacant properties first to inspect. I just thought I'd on the inspection standards.
Mm-hmm.
You showed a book.
Yeah.
Is there just like a lot of when you look at the Lawrence program, what they are inspecting for fits on a page and a half of paper. Is theirs just a lot less fluff than that, or is it you're looking at less things?
No, Lawrence uses the same code we do, the International Property Maintenance Code. So if we're just out doing an exterior inspection of a house, this is the code that we use for those existing buildings. What Lawrence has done is selected a certain group of requirements out of here that they apply to their rental inspections, and those are the requirements that they base their incentives on. So if you, let's say it's 20, they pick 20 requirements out of this code to base their program on, that's the requirements that are gonna be based on whether your unit passes that inspection for the purpose of their rental program or not. So if you have five or less violations of those, again, I think it's 26 is what he told me that they've selected out of here for their program. So if you have five or less violations of that 26, then you would gain the incentive to not be inspected again for whatever their extended length of time is. At the same time, if they recognize violations of the full code, they're still going to note those. So you might have 10 or 12 violations, but if only five of them are pertinent to that rental list that you're referring to, then they're still going to get the incentive, even though they may have more violations in a broader sense than what that program actually refers to. But they use the same code. I don't know if it's the same edition, but it's the same set of regulations.
So the violations that would fall outside of, let's say, that 26, you would notate those. Is that owner still, I would assume they still have to?
I believe that's what they do. They still cite those and they still need to be corrected, but it does not affect their rental license and their ability to maintain that with a passing inspection.
Do we legally have to do that? I mean, when someone goes in and does a fire inspection on a property, if they notice a violation that's outside of what's in the fire inspection, they
will address those. I mean, Commissioner, I have always, for a long time, been not in favor of trying to pick and choose what's important in a code and what's not. That's my opinion. I feel like this is a pretty minimum set of standards that a structure has to meet, and and it's not that onerous. And so to try and separate out what we feel is more important or less important, I have a little more of a difficult time with that. That's me, because I've been in the thousands of units and cited probably everything in this book at one time or another, and I think it's all important. So, you know, now having said that, when we had our mandatory program in 2011, we did somewhat the same thing. We left out a few things. It wasn't as many as Lawrence did, but we had a few things that were left out. We still looked for the full gamut, but some of the items that are in here did not affect whether they passed under that program or not. So does that, I know that's kind of complicated, but I hope that answers your question.
Thank you.
Other question?
Well, I think it's probably time to listen to the public here if we can. I just remind everybody, we have a timer here, so in order to let everybody have an opportunity to speak, you're limited to 5 minutes per person, and there'll be a 30 second prior to the 5 minute beep, so you'll kind of know when you're getting to the end. And this is really an opportunity for you to express your opinion. It's not a kind of a back and forth Q&A with anyone up here or with Brad, so this is just your ideas on and your thoughts on this particular ordinance that we have. So as you come forward, please just sign in and state your name, and we'd be glad to hear from you.
Sign in over I'm Jan Gallitzer. I think all of you know me. I wear a bunch of hats, but I came tonight as a homeowner. I live at 1504 Humboldt. I've lived at that location for 47 years, and I've invested a lot of money in that property, and it's our family homestead. Prior to 2017, when the previous inspection program was in place, it was obvious in our neighborhood that there were threatened inspections, and a lot of landlords made a lot of improvements to their property that they had not touched in many years. This was really good for our neighborhood and for my property value. Since that has changed, since 2017, no such work has happened in my neighborhood. It is true that some landlords simply gave up and sold their properties, and that was okay with us, because if you're a bad landlord and you're not going to take care of your properties, we'd rather have you not own property in our neighborhood. So I would like to say that I think that the previous inspection program had a very positive effect on this community. So that's one point. Another point, we make a big deal at various levels in this community saying how much we love our soldiers and we love our students. One of my other hats is I'm chair of the Public Housing Authority Commission, and in that capacity I drive around the neighborhoods and I look at rentals. If we really love our students and our soldiers, we wouldn't be letting them live in some of the properties that I see as I drive around the older neighborhoods. It's embarrassing to me that we allow properties to be in those conditions. I don't know what they look like on the inside, but some of them look really bad on the outside. If we really love our soldiers and our students and we recognize the economic advantage we have having them live here, I think we should be more kind and more considerate and more caring about how they live in our community. We have a lot of trouble with affordable housing in this community. Rents are really high. But I think that's a separate issue. And as a homeowner and a person who's invested in this community and who has children who have homes in this community, I sure would like to see some rules and regulations apply to people who own property, just like people who own restaurants or people who own businesses. When you go into a restaurant, there are rules, and we were talking about this. You don't have to worry when you go into a restaurant whether their kitchen is clean, because at some point it's going to be investigated and it's going to be closed down if it's not. I think that we should have the same safety in our housing in our community, and I hope you will seriously consider putting some kind of an inspection program back in place so that we can feel that the people who live in our community are safe. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else, please?
First of all, thank you, Commissioners, for allowing us to speak tonight in public comments. My name is Noah Auctioner. I'm a student here at Kansas State University. I'm here to represent the thousands of students I represent each week at K-State, the thousands of students who deserve better from their landlords. We know that there are many students on our campus that have been fighting this issue. In fact, this is one of the number one issues I hear about students from students every day, the lack of accountability that landlords have when it comes to ensuring that their properties are safe. The last thing anyone should have to worry about as if they have a safe place to come home to at night. It is obvious that educating the public on how to receive an inspection isn't enough. When I heard that only 99 out of the 13,000 rentals have been inspected, I was shocked and honestly frightened. We should not put the burden on tenants in our community when it comes to inspections. They should never feel intimidated when it comes to making sure that where they live is safe. I'm here to offer my full support for the rental inspections here in Manhattan. The current system is out of date, and frankly, it puts lives at risk. It is disappointing to me that landlords are not willing to put safety as their top priority when it comes to properties. I care about this issue because I care about the students I represent. I also care about the image of our community and the neighborhoods surrounding our campus. Some of the properties in and around our campus are noticeably not up to code from street view. How do you think that looks to a potential student and their family when they're visiting the city of Manhattan and considering Kansas State University? In a study that Renters Together provided with me, they found that less than 1% of the properties licensed in Manhattan have been inspected for any kind of code compliance. To me, that's not only horrifying, but it's kind of shocking. And as a Republican and the son of a small business owner, like many of the people in this room, I understand the idea of keeping government out of the way of private corporations. But I also understand the high importance of keeping people safe. I truly believe this is an issue of safety for our students at Kansas State and the people of Manhattan. At K-State, we practice the idea of family, caring for one another, and being there to help. I am deeply concerned that members of my Wildcat family are putting their lives at risk every day when they go home to their properties that aren't up to code. Growing up in a tight-knit community in western Kansas, I was always taught to do what is right, be there for others, and never do harm. It's time we bring those same small town values right here to our small town in Manhattan. This Manhattan community is incredible. There's a reason year after year we come in on top as one of not only our state's but nation's best place to live. Let's start taking that ranking serious by making sure that our tenants across our city aren't scared each and every day about the mold or hell, even the floor caving in from underneath them because their landlord didn't comply with basic safety codes and the city isn't enforcing that most cities across the country are enforcing. This issue is simple. Rental properties licensed by the city of Manhattan should be inspected to ensure that they meet basic safety standards. The city should create and follow a safety standard and create an enforcement team to inspect properties and hold landlords accountable. These standards should be non-negotiable and should be conducted on a regular basis. Moving forward, I trust the city commission will make the right decision to put the safety of the residents of our community first. The current rental registration program is out of date and not up to par in any way, shape, or form, and honestly, I was surprised when I found out about the issues. The current rental registration program is out of date, as I said earlier, and does not prioritize the safety of the public or the people of Manhattan in any way. If the city of Manhattan wants to remain as one of the state and nation's best place to live, it should ensure that facilities that people will call home are safe and up to code. Today, I'm here on behalf of the renters who don't have a voice, who don't have the time, and the renters who frankly deserve better. I know that the people in this room all care deeply about our community. I saw it when I first moved here about a year ago to start my job and to start classes here at Kansas State. I know that this is one of the reasons that Manhattan is one of the top places in the country and the state of Kansas to call home, because you, the city commissioners, and the people of this city deeply care about its image, that the people at Kansas State deeply care what our campus looks like and deeply care about the investment we make in this community. That's why we're so passionate about making sure that our students are safe, and we're so passionate about making sure that other members of our Wildcat family are safe each and every day when they go home. That's why I'm here. Let's do the right thing and make rental inspection standard here in Manhattan. Thank you.
Thanks, appreciate it.
Good evening, commissioners. Thank you for having us here this evening or allowing us to talk to this important issue this evening. My name is Maureen Shahan. I live at 1000 Pierre. I'm both a private homeowner and the owner of a rental property here in Manhattan. In almost every industry, there's a system of checks and balances, regulations and inspections that ensure that the public is protected, that products are safe, and that consumers get what they pay for. For example, restaurants have to pass periodic inspections. Unfortunately, here in Manhattan, the rental housing industry is almost totally unregulated. This situation allows unscrupulous landlords to offer unsafe properties for rent. The property registration program does not address the safety or fitness of a property for habitation. The program under which tenants are responsible for requesting inspection is insufficient and problematic for several reasons, primarily, in my opinion, because it places responsibility on the consumer, not the business owner. For owners, an inspection program would help ensure that properties do not fall into disrepair and would provide incentive for owners of poorly maintained properties to bring them up to a reasonable standard. I am aware that rental prices in Manhattan are high. However, I'm also aware that poorly maintained properties have just as high of rent as the rental prices for well-maintained properties. And while personal responsibility is crucial, we cannot expect renters to know whether a property is safe and compliant with the codes. It's time for Manhattan to hold property owners accountable. Thank you.
Thank you. Would you mind signing that on? Anyone else, please? And come on up while she's signing, that'd be fine. You can go ahead if you want.
Okay. My name is Jonathan Cole. I live at 822 Fremont, Apartment 3. I come before you today because I am concerned about the state of housing in Manhattan. I live with several friends that have told me that they knew their rights with the code inspection policy that we currently have in place, and they were still taken advantage of by their landlords. Unfortunately, the stories that I've heard are not unique to those people. It's a common theme that we have noticed around the city. And it demonstrates to me that the fact that we simply have an education policy with a current rental registration program is not enough. These people knew their rights and they took advantage of the code inspection policy, and unfortunately they were taken advantage of or retaliated by landlords for holding them accountable. This educational program has been going on for years now, yet annually we only have 99 rental properties that are inspected. That's less than 1% of all rental properties. This is exactly why Lawrence actually switched to their rental inspection program. This came out of their code services department. Their head, Brian Jimenez, even said, like, this is why I started advocating for a rental inspection program, was because the education program we had was failing. And so I strongly urge the city commission to look into supporting an ordinance to implement a rental inspection program. And thank you for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else, please?
My name is Jacob Miller. I'm a graduate student at Kansas State University, and I live at 1403 LaGore. I've heard a lot about the needs of renters, and I want to just reiterate the wants, or maybe iterate them. It was the second most dissatisfying item on the 2017 community survey. Rental inspections were specifically identified by a diverse multi-sector group of 95 community stakeholders, including renters, landlords, property managers, and homeowners in the community supported affordable housing project. I was a former GSC member, graduate student council member, and I heard a lot of students, both mainly grad but also undergrad, talk about the abhorrent conditions in rentals specifically. And this helps me go off of Noah's point that the Student Government Association at K-State unanimously passed a resolution in support of rental inspections because of unsafe rental housing. I was not aware of this issue until last summer, and I was pulled in by the stories of fellow grad students. The weight of the want seems to go beyond the capacity of this room. So if we are serious about the want, the only question becomes, what are we going to do about it?
Thank you. Appreciate it. Anyone else, please?
Hello, commissioners and city staff. My name is Rachel Shivers. I rent a property at 3552 Dempsey Road. And I wanted to share a lot of reflections based on the insufficiency of the current rental registration program. One of the things that I found really striking is that if there's an average of 99 interior rental inspections being conducted on a stock of more than 13,000 units, that means that less than 1% of properties licensed in Manhattan have been inspected for any kind of code compliance. And the reason why that's a problem is that there is a prevalence of major safety concerns experienced by tenants. So there's a large discrepancy between the experience of tenants in Manhattan, which is that it's common to experience safety issues with their housing. For example, one of the most recent stories that I heard was that the cold air return ducts had been removed in an older home and just carpeted over without any flooring replaced underneath there. And the tenant there didn't have the finances to break her lease and pay another deposit and first month's rent, but it wasn't a safe situation for her toddler to be living in. And so with this large discrepancy between like how many inspections are happening and how many violations are being found, between that and the experience of tenants in Manhattan, to me says that this current system is failing at some level to ensure safety for Manhattan tenants. The current registration program and code inspection system relies not only on tenant knowledge of the code inspection, but also the tenant to be the one requesting the code inspection. Simply increasing the education is not going to resolve the barriers of the current systems for several reasons. As some other people referred to, an organization called Renters Together, that renters are coming together to advocate for their needs. As part of that group, we've spoken to over 100 community members and have uncovered several consistent themes on how the current system is failing. These themes include things reported by tenants like landlord intimidation, tenant fear of landlord retaliation. As John Cole mentioned, we know students or community members who have been wrapped up in legal battles for over a year based on the substandard conditions of their housing. and the cost to them, both financially, to their mental health, to their physical health, to their ability to function at work and school, is just too drastic and something that shouldn't be happening in our community. So when we ask renters to describe their rental experience in Manhattan in one word, some of the responses that we've heard are unsatisfactory, dehumanizing, challenging, chaotic, tragic, scary, disgusting, frustrating, confusing, shocking, overwhelming, disappointing, and the list goes on. And it shouldn't be this way, and it doesn't have to be this way. And so that is why we are asking for the City of Manhattan to implement a rental safety inspection program that would require at least a certain percentage of properties to undergo a safety inspection of some kind. And I would, what Brad shared about, you know, his opinion is the full code is equally important, and I can understand that perspective. But I would also advocate for, at the minimum, asking ourselves what are the basic features of a unit to be safe and habitable for its residents. And I think that that's just something that we can all agree upon, is that rental housing should be safe to live in. If it's on the market and you can purchase a place to, or rent a place to live in and pay to live there, it should be safe at the minimum. It may not have all the bells and whistles, but at least it should be a safe place to live. And it's my personal opinion that tenants should not primarily be the ones monitoring whether or not rentals licensed by the city are safe for them to live in. Not only is that not their expertise, but it's really not their responsibility. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, appreciate it. Did you sign in? I didn't watch you very closely. Okay.
Thanks for the reminder.
Anyone else, please?
Hello, my name is Donna Shank Hamlin. I live at 1922 Leavenworth. I'm a homeowner, and I had been a renter for 11 and a half years before I bought my home. I live in an old home, and in the process of upgrading that, we discovered, as many people who give into restoration, that there had been some terrible plumbing work. As a matter of fact, the upstairs bathtub was about to fall through the floor. And in some earlier iteration of basement plumbing, the work was so shoddy that we actually had to bring in steel to support the floor on the first floor. This kind of older housing sometimes gets used as rental, and it's my opinion that we really need to have, along with the excellent construction permit-driven rentals inspection system, a more systematic approach. That said, I think that the Lawrence program is weak. I would favor actually to have a random selection so that you would have surprise inspections of registered rental property. But I also think on a positive side, we should have a system of certification that would be a positive marketing tool for those people in this competitive environment we're in to show that their property is certified as excellent. So I think we need a carrot and a stick. I think that random inspections rather than X percentage of so many property owners, it would be a better strategy. Just as in inspections of food, you don't know that it's going to happen. You try to be prepared. But at the same time, we need to have certification that is positive. Thank you.
Thank you. Saw someone else starting to get up. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Elizabeth Dungusky. I just actually moved into the city from being on campus housing. My husband's been a student. I've gone through the college housing experience. I lived in Minnesota in what's called Dinky Town. And it's not the greatest housing. People have a mentality about, oh, it's just a college student. Well, he's a college student too, and we've had a little one. And I've seen places that I couldn't let her walk on the floors when we were looking for an apartment. There were nails on the floors. They didn't have drywall for at least 3 feet up, and they were going to rent it to us. You know, you can't judge who's going to live somewhere. And I mean, no, not every college student's responsible, but not every college student. It's exhausting when you are the college student who's working hard and trying, and you contribute to a community. And right now, college enrollments around the country are down. I grew up in Kearney, Nebraska, which is a college town very similar, very, very similar to Manhattan. It has a very high population, but those college students become citizens of this community a lot of times. And so I really think that a rental inspection, that, you know, knowing that you can be safe somewhere. I mean, her to go to daycare. They go through a whole process to be licensed as a daycare provider in this state. In this town, in any college town, I mean, it's still important to take care of, you know, the student that's 18 years old and is trying to, or 19 years old, trying to figure it out. You don't have time with everything else to go and say, okay, what's a code? How do I know if my, oh, am I okay? Oh, wait, did you know that filmy water might mean that there's mold in the apartment? You don't know that stuff. It takes years of learning hard life lessons. But, you know, saying that Manhattan's a place that college students can come to and live and feel safe, that's something that right now I think is a really good idea, because it's also marketable. I mean, it's good for personal reasons too, but honestly, right now there's a competition to be the for the college, but as a community of Manhattan, to say, we're a town you want to come to. You're selling the town, not just the college. And so, honestly, wanting to come to a town, I mean, we didn't have time to do a lot of apartment hunting when we moved here, so we just lived on campus, because Manhattan's the only place with college housing for on-campus housing for a long distance. But, you know, you make a choice to live off campus, and it's a whole different world that we've experienced. We found things that I didn't even in my wildest dreams of college living think were possible to have. And it's exhausting to hunt and hunt and just hope to find somewhere, not with extras, but just somewhere that you don't have to wonder what's out there or what's in the apartment or if it's okay. So honestly, I think it's good for Manhattan, but I think it's also something that is necessary for safety.
Thank you. Anyone else, please?
Good evening. I'm Linda Cook. My residence is at 3703 Birch Court in Manhattan. And actually, I'm here representing not myself as a resident, but the University of Kansas State University and our leadership group. I wish I had some answers for you, suggestions, but I don't. But I can tell you a number one priority and concern of the university leadership is safe, healthy, and affordable housing for students. And how we achieve that, we know is a struggle, but we think it does. It's an area that does require some attention and some focus and some direction. You know, we recognize that it's a supply and demand issue. Our enrollment is down right now, so there are a lot of vacancy signs out there, and hopefully we can help our students and teach them to negotiate and find better apartments and living spaces than what is currently out there in some locations. We also feel that it's and from talking with students, that it's difficult for them to ask for these inspections and to drive, you know, the attention to the fact that they're living in some unsafe conditions because they can't find any other housing they can afford, and then they receive the retaliation from the landlord. So we do not put all landlords in this category. there are many great landlords out there that offer a great product, but there are those landlords that are not. That's the area we want to focus on when we try to attract more students, and housing is an important part of getting students to come to the university. Cost is a major concern for students, and the students we need to attract in the future are going to be more cost sensitive. So housing and safe housing is going to be more important. They have a lot of options for other higher education other than K-State. And if housing isn't going to be an area where they feel safe, they aren't going to come to K-State. So that's one of the areas that, however we can help figure this out, and particularly it's getting rid of the really slummy homes. And it starts by, you see a lot of them from the outside, so what can we do to go in and, you know, work with those landlords that are not maintaining them and upgrading them to at least the health and safety standards that every person in this community should and does deserve. So again, I'm sorry, I don't have any answers or suggestions. If it's more inspections, random inspections, you know, that would be something that, if there's a way that we can help work that out, and that's a way to get to the successful end, then that is something that we would be supportive of. But again, right now it's just letting everyone know that the university does see it as a concern for the student population, as well as, you know, just trying to attract economic growth in the city of Manhattan. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thomas Kerrigan, 2125 Sloan Street. I've been on this side of the street a couple of different, as a homeowner, a renter now, and potentially a new homeowner again, short time. And I'm glad that this is back here in front of the commission again, because I thought when we had it the last time, we had it, you know, going pretty good. There were probably some things that a lot of people didn't like, the cost, maybe that needs to be, you know, dealt with a different way, so that these places that have, you know, 2,000 units, they're the ones that are, you know, getting hit the hardest by this, obviously, and they're probably not the problem, you know, more than likely not. But as a renter the last couple of years, I've been very, very fortunate. I have a great landlord. I can call him anytime, text him, and he says whatever needs done, get done. I'm a full-grown adult. I'm fully capable of taking care of myself. I have a young son who's a freshman at K-State. He's not. And so I hear some of the stuff from him, from his friends, and this is not a joke. This is serious business here in this town. And if we want this town to grow forth and be something that we can be proud of, I think we need to take a harder look at this like you guys are doing now and figure something out, because those places aren't going to get any better on their own. Thank you.
Thank you. Did you sign in?
No.
Okay.
My name is Phil Anderson. I live at 1719 Fairchild Avenue. I've lived in Manhattan since 1980. I've owned rental property since 1981. I've heard a lot of stories since I was on the faculty at K-State for 31 years. A lot of my students in public speaking, one of their issues would be residential property and their concerns about the safety or lack thereof of those properties. And I've heard not only dozens, but hundreds of stories about those properties. And so you're hearing them tonight too. Pleases me tonight about many of the speakers have said is that they've had this experience and they're indicating clearly that to you. But I'm also sensing that they're beginning to organize a little bit. And what I would say to them that is important is that not only do you not appear to need to appear before the commission, but Democracy in Action is a contact sport, and you need to be registered to vote as well. And I think we're going to see that. My experience in the rental property, I own rental property around the university, and all of it that I bought, I had to renovate quite severely because it was in very poor condition, which is why I bought it, because it was cheap. And I had the resources to be able to do the work, or a lot of the work, and still hire the professional people that were licensed to do what they had to do, the plumbers, the electricians, that sort of thing, and brought them up to code and got them rented, and it was a satisfactory occasion. But the houses around many of those properties were not maintained, and they were very poorly maintained. One property that I owned that I did renovate had four space heaters, even though it had a furnace. There was a space heater in two of the bathrooms and the kitchen. And there was also a rental unit in the basement, space heaters. So the first thing we did, of course, was to run the proper ductwork so the furnace could do its job. But these were open flame space heaters. And I've heard so many stories of extreme danger like that. Now, if you've walked through the neighborhoods around the university, as I have, because I live near the university. I've almost 40 years here. I've always lived in the older neighborhoods. I like living there. And if you walk down the street and visually you look at some of these neighborhoods, I have looked at over 1,000 houses and have my own way of documenting a vast majority of a whole block would be dwellings that are in very poor condition. I mean, just visually from the outside, you can see them. You can see the characteristics. The porch is sagging. The roof needs repair. There are windows that obviously don't open or close properly. That kind of thing is all over the city. And I think it's important, especially with the reputation that the city is trying to maintain, with NBAF coming online within 2 or 3 years, that we need to focus especially on the neighborhoods around the university where many of the university students try to live. But there's no reason why those houses that have been turned into 2 or 3 dwelling units that were originally single family can't be maintained either as that and brought up to code or returned to single family. There's no reason why a single family can't live next to rentals, providing that those rentals are maintained. On my block on Fairchild Avenue, I own and operate with my wife Dawn the Anderson Bed and Breakfast. And we bought that and completely renovated. It was a huge job, took us over a year. But we are surrounded by rentals. And we're surrounded by rentals that would not pass code. And the rental to my east actually has a dead walnut tree on the property. And the people who lived there, was a military family, had 4 children, had a hammock out there. And one day, a huge limb on that fell. Fortunately, they were not playing in the hammock at that time, because if they had been and one of them were hit, they would have been killed. And the 3 units to the west of me all are in violation. Now, we keep our place up as nice as we can. 14 houses on my block, 7 of them are rentals, and I think it is the city's obligation to very seriously consider this problem of what everybody here has said tonight and to address this issue seriously. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
My name is Mark Nelson. I live at 1728 Laramie. I'm a graduate student here at K-State in sociology, and I also grew up here in Manhattan, so I care a lot about this. I just kind of want to speak a little bit to what is happening in Lawrence with their inspection program, which seems to be something that's been really great and really effective for that community. In 2017, a little over 1,000 inspections were done. Compared to 100 here. And in that time, they found 1,909 violations. And additionally, it's actually been really affordable for them as well. And in 3 years, the program has ended up paying for itself, which I think is awesome and is a great thing to consider in terms of the cost benefit of it. And I also, as a graduate student, as someone who's grown up in this community and has loved it so much, if we have the opportunity to guarantee safe and affordable housing for people, and in this case, if we did something based off of the fine structure for the Lawrence program that doesn't really cost the city that much in the end, I think it's our responsibility to provide that for people. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else, please?
Diane Barker. I owned a fabulous bungalow, 1809 Leavenworth, for a long time. I sold that. I'm currently living in Grant Township, but I moved to Manhattan to go to college in 1969, so I used to pride myself on having lived or partied in just about every structure in town. So I've seen what we're dealing with, and I want to thank how everybody brought out the underlying issues. And the underlying issues are that people's safety is being jeopardized. I once rented a little one-story house, and during a party, we knew the floor was rotten, but we didn't know when it would go. The floor collapsed. A rotten floor collapsed. I think wiring, unsafe wiring, is one of the biggest problems. So I do hope that we find a way to institute some coding system, some inspections, and it should make everybody feel proud of our proof that we care about people's safety. And whether or not they have very much money to afford housing, it ought to be safe. Thank you.
Thank you. We had someone, I think on the right, who gave up his place.
Commissioners, my name is Bryce Ebert, and I've got the opportunity to stand here several times before, and we're back at it. As I hear kind of the common theme across the board that I think we can all agree upon is safety, everyone's safety. That seems to be a pretty unified voice, as there are probably differencing opinions. Like Phil mentioned, you know, there's always two sides. There's the tenant side and the landlord side, and I do appreciate you acknowledging that there are good landlords. It kind of the feel that first came out is they're all landlords are bad, so thankful for that comment. You know, there's always two sides to a story, and just looking at from a safety standpoint, I think it's very important that everyone's safety is important. And once we start segmenting out a section of Manhattan or areas of Manhattan or a certain property type, these are going to get hypothetically inspected, but the house next door might. And you know, with that limb you were talking about, you know, that could happen anywhere. And I want to realize what is our expectation of a rental inspection program. What are they going to look at? Like Brad talked about that book, that International Property Maintenance Code book. Everything's important to him. We all have different, you know, pinch points in understanding. So what would that look like if something did get implemented? And I was on the committee before, back in 2009, when we were discussing this thing. So I've been around the block, and I've lived housing on a daily basis. And would it be all right if I touched on our ride-along? So I took Commissioner McKee on a ride-along around Manhattan just to show him what I see on a daily basis and look at all different areas of Manhattan, from the flooding, most recent flooding from Labor Day weekend, to houses that are still in disrepair, to certain areas of town. And I gave him a pop quiz, and I asked him, I said, can you tell which house is a rental and which one is an owner-occupied? We're just sitting in the car. And he's like, oh, it's a trick question. So he picked this house, and it was inaccurate. He picked the house that was actually owner-occupied as the rental, and the rental was the owner-occupied. So we drove all over town, from the east side of town, out to Colbert Hills, to up where a few of the other commissioners live. And, you know, in Manhattan, there's rentals at all levels. There's 120-year-old rentals, and there's 5-year-old rental houses. So looking at our community as a whole and wanting to put that good foot forward as to what it looks like, I think we need to realize if we put in an inspection program, that does not equal safe housing. There's not a direct correlation there, because we have something, an inspection program, which we already have an inspection program, it's already in place. I spend a lot of time, not so much with Brad, but his crew, doing different things that come up, whether it's a tenant that called it in, or a neighbor, or reported on the reported app. You know, we work with them all the time, and just because we'd have a program doesn't mean that we're gonna live and everything is gonna be perfect. And I was just in a house last week. An 82-year-old couple lives in there. They've lived there for 25 years, walking through their house, and they don't have any smoke detectors or carbon monoxide detectors. To me, their life is equally as important, and they don't even have some basic safety features. So if we can't just inspect a certain sector. And, you know, hearing about Lawrence, and you know, if they're doing a percentage or the different programs across the country, we can't just do a certain percentage of them. We either need to do all of them, 100%, or none of them, because we need to be unified across there. Because that purple book that Brad holds up, that applies to all properties in Manhattan, whether it's a rental or it's an owner-occupied. And we just got a code violation today for some peeling paint on some fascia. I think, you know, yep, that is a code violation, and that will get corrected. And I had the opportunity to go to the meeting a couple weeks ago with the rental guys over here and gals, trying to encourage this inspection program. I feel we could get a lot more accomplished by working together than we would be on opposite sides of the table. We hear a lot of stories, and just knowing what are we doing to follow those things through, and realizing that we already have a code inspection in place, we just need to flex that muscle and use what's already there. Because once this starts, like it did before, there's a lot of unintended consequences that are unforeseen by people. We don't know what they are until we start opening them up. In summary, safe housing for everyone. That's the unified goal across the board. So inspect them all or none of them. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yeah, please come up.
All right. Well, thank you all for providing the opportunity to speak. I represent over 22,000 students at K-State as student body vice president. I'm fortunate enough to know some of the commissioners, but not all of you. And I would like to provide some brief remarks on safe housing in Manhattan. I think we owe it to our students to provide safe housing. As Bryce said, that's really hard to do. You either have to inspect all of them or some of them, but I'd encourage some kind of solution. If students feel unsafe in their houses, who else will live in them? My friends, so many people I know, have pretty low standards for housing, basically because they don't know what their standards should be. They don't have that life experience as referenced earlier. And I'd also encourage you, as Manhattan grows, as we look forward to gathering census data in 2020, we are really looking forward to providing that safe and equitable housing for students and providing a community that people want to move into. With growth in the community through NBAF and other companies that are coming in. I think we owe it to future students and future residents and current residents for years and years to provide that safe and equitable housing. Code Services does a great job. I've gotten the opportunity to know Brad pretty well through organizing Furniture Amnesty Day, but I think that there's always more that can be done. So I'd encourage our city commissioners, as Linda said, as a student and a person representing K-State, I'm not an expert on what inspections should look like, and I think providing inspections to every single house would be a bit of a headache for Brad and his crew, but I really think that something should be done in order to provide fair and equitable housing for students, to provide them a safer place to go, and when future students who are thinking about other schools like CU Boulder, UNL, Mizzou, all these other communities are looking at their community. They're looking at institutions that are very similar, and I really, really don't want them to make that decision off of the community and what the housing looks like that they could be living in the next several years of their life. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Anyone else?
Hope Bingosh. I live here in Manhattan since 2010, and I left northern Kansas, still in northern Kansas, for safety reasons, with my three daughters, and then now I also have a grandson. Our current living situation is we had to move from our previous house because of mold. Landlord was somewhat cooperative with assisting us with getting that cleaned up. We had a He was given one option to move to, and then that's where we are at currently since September of last year. They covered up a bunch of mold and insect remains. If it was inspected, I feel that somebody with more of a trained eye would have been able to see that, as opposed to me moving in and then figuring out 2 weeks to a month later, said something to the landlord, and that it never happened. They did do an inspection, but I wasn't allowed to see that, and I was just told what happened. I do have a child with asthma and epilepsy, and she, of course, as her seizures have increased, because if you can't breathe, your brain's not firing right. Anyway, the main thing is safety first. I feel as a mother, grandmother, that I should be able to go to a home and be safe. I feel safer unlocking my front door in Manhattan than I do breathing the air in my home. And that's not right, not right at all. I do feel inspections would help with that, to where, you know, like I said, a trained eye, you know, and then, you know, I'm old. You know, I have been around, I know what to look for. You know, I'm not completely oblivious. But there's things that I just can't see that someone who does inspections would be able to do so. And as previous people have said, it is a business, and there should be inspections just as a restaurant. I do have experience with that. Now I'm a nurse, but you know, I still have to have my CEUs and all that. I do commute to Wamego, live in Manhattan, work in Wamego. Why wouldn't I just move to Wamego? It's cheaper, and I don't know if they have inspections or not, but it is cheaper there, so it's safer. I have to have a background check to be a renter. You know, why can't they be inspected? Should be checks and balances, should be both ways. And you know, just for a quality of life, safety first. Safety first is primary for everything. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Anyone else?
Where do you live, Hope?
In Manhattan.
What's your address? Up here. What's your address?
3000 Tuttle Creek Boulevard.
Okay. Thank you.
That's the third home I've lived in that community. 2 years.
All right. Well, seeing no further comment from the public, we'll close the public section of this and go back to the commission. So ask for any additional comments or maybe direction that you'd like to see Brad and the staff go?
I think everybody's waiting on me to start, so I will. So first, thank you all for being here, no matter what side. I think that last time we had this many people here, we were talking about disc golf. So I'm excited to see this many people here on an important issue here in Manhattan. I'm glad to see the commission talking, not only getting an update about where rental registration is at, but kind of looking further on what the city can do more. And this has really been a culmination of a year and a half of me trying to talk to stakeholders and bring different people in the room to have discussions about how we could be better. Because when the rental registration program first passed, I had hopes that code inspections would increase. The number of units being inspected would increase. That didn't pan out in that way. So I think that we have to look at doing more. So just to get right into it, I wrote down what I want to go through. So first, I mean, I think the update said it itself. What we're doing in terms of rental registration isn't enough, and I would be supportive of city staff starting to build a rental inspection ordinance based off of the City of Lawrence's program. I don't want to get into the details of arguing exactly what rental inspection should look like, because I think there's a better time and place for that. From a high level, I would like to see us start working on that. And there's a few reasons why. Before I was on the commission, I saw these things. But even in the year and a half that I've been on the commission, the amount of people that have approached me and told me about issues that they were having is astounding. Even just last week, I was in a house where the I was with friends, and they lived in the basement, or not the basement, but the main floor. And above them, there was a separate unit. And they told me that the separate unit above them did not have heat. That the lady who was living up there just had space heaters, and that was it. And I was like, does she know that that is like, that's a total code violation? She can call the city, she can get an inspection. And so they followed up with her, and the next day told her that was something that she could do, and she proceeded to do that. But the thing is how many of those people are we missing through the cracks? It took, we have 5,000-6,000 new members of our population every single year come to Manhattan, and to educate that transient of a population every year is nearly impossible. I mean, it took the city 8 years, and I was a city running for city commission before I didn't know I needed to license my pet here. I mean, there's no difference. It's the same thing. We have to do better in reaching out to them. Many of you notated, I think this is a standard in many industries, right? You don't go to a restaurant and ask to see their kitchen, as someone noted, because you know it's been expected. I don't buy a new car and run it against a wall because I know it already meets some level of safety standards, right? And I don't know how to look at a car and make sure that it's going to do what it's supposed to do. 19-year-old Jared wasn't touring a house and looking for egress windows, but I would have looked for an egress window if I was in a basement and the top of my house caught on fire. And we've seen those old homes in Manhattan catch on fire and burn down before the fire department ever got there. And thank the Lord, there's never been someone in that basement in Manhattan. Some of our neighbor partners, I'm not sure that's the case, but if that were to happen, that was an event that the city could have been involved in preventing from happening. Some of the arguments against that, I mean, even myself, when I was going through this process, were things that held me back from wanting to push for rental inspections. One of them is affordable housing and the potential costs that rental inspections could add on to that. I have a hard time thinking about us doing anything with affordable housing, offering some kind of tax credits for landlords for building affordable housing, and then knowing that 2 or 3 years later, after we give that developer or that landlord that tax credit, that housing could be in disrepair. I don't think that we can have a conversation about affordable housing unless we can start with safe housing first. That's where the conversation has to start. The argument that we're segmenting people out, that we're treating rental properties different than we are homeowners, and I would say, yeah, we are, for a couple of different reasons. The first reason, as a homeowner, you can control your destiny, right? If something in your house is unsafe, you can change that. I remember in one of my apartments, I changed the shower head because mine wasn't like putting out much water, and I put a newer, better shower head in, and my landlord actually got mad at me for doing that, was upset. That was a choice as a tenant that I couldn't make, that I learned that I couldn't make because I didn't own that home. The second thing that's vastly different is you are operating a business, period. you're operating a business. If someone wants to take a bowl of Cheerios home and mix arsenic in it and eat it, that's their choice. But when I buy a box of Cheerios from Walmart, I'm expecting it to not have arsenic in it. But if you take it home and you want to make that choice, you can do that. That's all. We hold different businesses to different standards, and we're not doing that in this one segment of this market. And I think it's important that we do that. My first apartment that I rented here in Manhattan, I never saw before I moved in. I found out about a week before I came to K-State, 2 weeks, that I wasn't going to get a dorm because the dorms were filled up. So I had a call, and I rented an apartment based on the pictures. And there's thousands of people in our community that do that, that are transient, they're military. They're renting places before they ever get to see them. So wouldn't it be nice to know that the apartment that you're looking at met some basic level of safety? And right now, that's not an assurance that we have here in Manhattan. So again, I don't want to debate the particulars of the Lawrence ordinance, but I would support city staff moving forward with developing an ordinance based on that, and then having another work session where we can debate the particulars on how many properties we inspect, what's the fee going to be, what's the cost to the city. But just theoretically, I think that we should seriously explore something where we can do better for the people here in Manhattan.
Yeah, so I've been on the commission since, I think, 2012, I don't remember. So this has come up about three times since the time I've been on, and before I came on, it was there plenty more times during Commissioner Butler's tenure, as well as before him, it was there. So this isn't the first time we're seeing this, and each time this is actually very sparse. It'll get packed in the next few weeks as we move forward with some of the discussions. And one of the things I think we did in 2017 was trying to get something that was non-threatening to not only the way we wanted to do it, but we wanted to make it such that the property owners wanted to be a part of it. They wanted to be part of the process and not anti-something, not anti-landlords, not anti-business owners. So we wanted to make it such that it was a compromise between the two. And I think we've achieved it. And now it's 2 years down, and we've seen some of the numbers. So we've had quite a few people go through the rental registration process. So we know where the units are. We know where everything is located. And I think that's a pretty remarkable thing that we've achieved just in those couple of years. In the next few years, we need to make some improvements. Some of the demographics that are not here are your African Americans, are internationals, are your senior citizens, are the disabled. So we have just one demographic in this room that's being represented. So just because they're silent and not here doesn't mean they don't have needs as well. And I think that when we talk about fixed income and the housing neighborhoods that we have, we need to look at a different way of doing things. We were at the National League of Cities over the weekend, about a week ago, and this was a big topic. Nationally, this is a big topic. Students are graduating with more debt. They're unable to buy homes well into their 30s, if then. And if you marry someone, then you have two people with high debt, so you might end up with anywhere between $50,000 to $100,000. That's more than previous generations. So even if you have a good paying job that's paying substantially, let's say $60,000 on both sides, you're still making decisions on whether to get married, whether to have one car or two cars, whether you want to have a house, and everything that goes with that. So there's already a lot of cost burden on our young students today, and these are your able-bodied, college-educated, good job citizens that want to contribute but can't afford housing. So that's something we need to look at as well. The needs of today are extremely different. As far as the rental registration, I think I'm open to options to how to do this. I don't think it's fair to have, say, unsafe housing. I've had three children, all of them now have jobs, but they lived on anything where they can just pay the bare minimum rent. And I always say it was just shocking to see what they lived in, but they were paying $100 or $200 rent because they had all of these other expenditures. You can't get hardly anything for $200, and they barely had anything for $200. And as a mom, that just saddens you to see that. But they didn't want my intervention. They wanted to kind of go through this process. But knowing certain codes or safety things, that was not a concern to them. That's not what they thought about. They just thought about how to get by day to day. So as elected officials, I think we need to look into this a little bit deeper. Rentals are a business, so I do consider this something that, you know, let's see how to do this a little differently without pushing them to other regions in around Manhattan. We don't want to push our rental owners and developers to other areas within the Flint Hills region. We still want them to build in Manhattan and be part of our community. So we need to work with them. Instead of we're doing this to you, we need to have them back at the table and work with us on some of these things. I'm surprised that as far as the, I don't know how many people actually went on to our Facebook website and saw all the properties that were there. One of the things we tried to do with SGA in past years is you have a Yelp thing where people can kind of rate how a house is or how an apartment is or whatever it is. I think with social media these days, maybe that's a different way that students can also do that. I don't think it's in the best interest of a city to do that. We can look at some kind of licensing structure or something like that, but we can't have star ratings. And I know those can be manipulated as well, but those types of evidence needs to come from the public, not from the city. We are only here to monitor how things are going, not be, you know, this is a great place or that's a bad place. That's not for us to say. So I think we just need to look at these things and how to do it. I don't know about the Lawrence one. I do remember how it was going there as far as their registrations. You still need consent from tenants. You still need to sign on. So we can't just go in. There are some tenants that don't want us to go in because they want that low cost and they know it's temporary. And there are some that want you to come in. So we need to navigate that as well. We don't want to send off our students in a different direction because of it and start locking their doors and hoping the city and government doesn't come in. So we need to work this in a very cautious manner together. It's going to be a long process. It's not going to happen overnight. It's going to be a long process. And hopefully we can build on what we already have. And I am proud of what we have. It might not look like much, but it took us months to get there. And our staff works extremely hard. And we have a lot of wonderful people in our community who work with us on that. So I want to continue that partnership. So we will get there. We're not where we need to be. We'll get there, though.
So to my thoughts, I sort of agree with Commissioner Reddy from the standpoint we need to tweak the program we have. But, you know, I voted, you know, I got on the commission, I guess, 2011 election. I was the deciding vote to throw out the rental inspection program. So I don't like the rental inspection program. And Phil and I, we've had a lot of discussions over this over the years. But let me explain why. I took notes on everybody that talked tonight, and there's a distinctive lack of data. There's a lot of I heard a story that this happened, and there's all these horror stories. But I'm a data guy. I want to know who, what, when, where, why, the date, and the specifics. If we have that, we can address it. Without it, it's just a bunch of stories. The second thing is, I've been very disappointed, and I'll use a term might offend some people maybe, but there seems to be a lack of courage out there. A lot of people have the courage to come to the commission. You don't have the courage to call the code office when there's something drastically wrong with your apartment. This makes absolutely no sense to me. Okay, I mean, I was a college student many years ago too, like the one lady said, it was 1969, a long time ago. And I didn't experience any of these problems. I mean, maybe it's a different sense of responsibility. But clearly, if you rent something and it's substandard and you know the floor is going to collapse, call the code office. We'll fix it. It's in our program. So any substandard property, there's no excuse for it because the tenant has to have some responsibility. How can it be the government? I'm not responsible for where you live. You make that decision, just like I made the decision on where I wanted to live. Now there's also, as Commissioner Reddy clearly pointed out, this thing called degree of excellence. You know, when I was a college student, I didn't live in the Ritz because I didn't have any money. I was living hand to mouth. It was tough. So we rented probably one of the worst apartments that existed in Richmond, Virginia. Shared it with my buddy. And we knew what we were paying for. But it was safe. You know, we had a smoke detector. Wasn't in the nicest part of town, but you know, we survived. And so I think, you know, that's one of the issues here. where if you start turning everything into the Ritz, you're going to price some people out of the market. Because when I was a college student, I was willing to just, as we said, suck it up. We suffer for a couple of years because that's just all I can afford. But I graduated and moved on from there. So I think that if people would just simply call, we could focus our energies on those properties that need to be fixed. And if you don't have the courage to call, I don't have a lot of sympathy for you. I have no empathy for those folks. You got to stand up and be counted. So do so. That would put the focus on the bad properties in town. Now, the other issue of safety. This one's really strange when we look at the Lawrence program. It randomly inspects a few properties. As the code office said, they want to get into one. They can't get the administrative warrant, so they just inspect another one. It's an illusion of safety. They haven't improved safety in those houses. And if you look at safety data in Manhattan, I don't really see any evidence, again, in data that there's a true safety problem where people have been hurt. It's not there. Now, think about safety. What if we passed an ordinance checking tires? We're going to make certain you have the right tire pressure in your car, and we'll inspect one tire every 3 years. And you can ensure then that you'll be safe, that your tire pressure will be correct. That's absolute nonsense. And I agree with the speaker that said if you're going to do safety, you got to do it 100%. You got to inspect everything every year. Like, I worry about my furnace. I'm not very good at that, so a guy comes to inspect it every year, and I pay the standard plumbing guys a few dollars. I think it's 100 or so a year to look at it. Okay, that's fine. That's taking care of safety. I don't want my furnace inspected once every 5 years. Not going to be safe. So I'm very fearful of inspection programs that give people the illusion of safety, because it will give you the illusion of safety. You're not safe unless it's looked at every year. And if you want to do that every year, we can do that. Probably going to cost $3 million. We'll need about 15 inspectors. And that cost is going to get passed on to somebody. I mean, it can be done. All right? But I'm not a real advocate of that. The other problem is, it is sort of flat against Kansas law if you look at it. Nobody sued Lawrence yet. It might happen. But basically, the Kansas law, which was initiated, I think, by some folks here in the rental community, that said, hey, the city commission's out of control with these programs. So they got Kansas to pass a law that said, hey, you can't do this. And I also think that these mandatory programs, they do violate your little Fourth Amendment rights. And we had some problems when we had our program, because what happens? Why is it that some students won't call? Because they know they've got too many people living in the apartment. That's why. And when the code office goes in, they'll figure out it's overoccupied. And that's one of the main reasons I believe students don't call, because they know that, hey, we can fit six people in here, and that'll save us money. But the code says we're only allowed to have four. But we're willingly going to violate that because we want to save money. I understand that. I was a college student, had to save money. So it makes sense. So one of the problems is you do these inspections, what happens? I think last time we had the mandatory program, there were at least three K-State students that wound up in the county jail as a consequence of it, because of things that were found, because the code inspector can't ignore it when he goes in. So there's some downside to this too, from the standpoint of let the government come in. Bad stuff can happen. So I'm just not in favor of it for that reason. Now, what am I in favor of? And a couple things said tonight caught my eye. I like this idea of certification, because I'm a believer in free market. And so these people are out here competing. We've got less college students. We've got more supply and demand on the market. So why don't we set up a program, have the city look at putting out a program saying, okay, you want a rental property? Call the code office. They'll inspect it using the full book that code likes, and we'll certify you as having passed, and we'll put it on a website. And then K-State could do the same and say, these particular landlords, property managers, apartment complexes have passed the city code and are therefore certified. Nobody else is. And then publish that as part of the education program. Now, that maybe, just through the capitalist system, might cause a few more people from the landlord side to say, hey, I want to go through the city inspection, because it's going to be out there much more effective than Yelp if we did it that way. And I don't know if there's any legal dangers in that, you know, but we're not saying that it's safe. We're saying it passed city certification, and we put the date there. You know, that's something I think is valid data that a college student could use. And if we could get K-State to partner with us on that and publish it on the K-State website in hours, I think that's the way to go. So I'm for taking this program and tweaking it, not making it mandatory, but let's see if we can come up with some kind of a certification program that will affect the marketplace. If you can affect the marketplace, that changes behavior. So that's sort of where I am tonight.
Before the rental registration program was adopted, I supported and continue to support rental inspection. And I think that that's the best we can do. I am convinced that we are doing those transient people, who students and soldiers and regular people, a disservice by attracting them here, bragging about it, and then having those horribly unpleasant experiences. It's not just unpleasant, it's financially devastating to some of the low-income people. I think it's our responsibility. I am pleased that the pleased that the registration program has functioned as well as it has, that I'd like to see a more assertive, aggressive, whatever, educational component. I think that we've been doing probably a minimal effort with regard to education. And don't take that personally, Brad. That's my opinion. I believe that the 60% rental figure that we throw around and have been throwing around since 2010 is significantly an underestimate. And I'm really interested in the 2020 census, because I think it will show with some of the big apartment complexes that have replaced individual homes, that I believe that number is significantly higher, and I'm looking for that data with an eager eye. I do approve of the current registration system with no fee. I don't know if we went to inspection. That's a totally other. I don't have a thought about that yet. I do think the communication, I'm pleased with the communication efforts and the improvement that has been brought along by the registration program, so that we have the contact information of the owner and hopefully the contact information of both the owner and the agent. That has been a real problem in the past, is trying to reach the right people. So we have that now, and it has been paying dividends by being able to email people and reach the current, 2019 world. I do think it's an added benefit, this registration system we have and potential inspection. As we approach the 2020 census, which is almost exactly 1 year from today, we are really going to be pushing to try to count every head there is in town and in the Riley County, for heaven's sake. And that is difficult when you have people who don't want to come forward for one reason or another, whether it's rental, hiding out for because you have too many people in a unit, or whether you're have some other issues. I sincerely appreciate K-State's advocacy, both the president's office, Linda Cook, the chief of staff, Lacey Pitts, vice president of the Student Governing Association. Before you, J- Jackie Hartman, and even, you know, we have had K-State leadership here at least the 3 years that I've been for on the commission, and it has been very important to me to have that advocacy. What we don't get a lot of are the actual stories or the actual statistics that perhaps the student attorney might have in the aggregate somehow, so that we can satisfy some desires for data, and how we need to consider how we can obtain that. Just in the end, to say that I do support the staff moving forward with an ordinance of some kind, and I can't speak to what it might be or the details, but it's clear to me that this community has gone for years with very few controls. The landlords have had free rein in most cases, as evidenced by some of the deteriorating houses we have. So we have 2 years now of rental registration. And if, you know, one of the things I can speak to is the appearance in the community, because the city can inspect exteriors. And so we saw an improvement. I believe we would see additional improvements. On my way to the meeting this evening, I saw a house on Fremont that has been orange placards on the doors that it's being condemned, I assume. Brad, is that true? Yep, condemned. So I know that the city is having to, when a building is brought to their attention, I know that they act on it. So, and it's long and laborious to condemn a facility or a house, anything, and actually tear it down. But we have been successful as a city. We've had abandoned houses with holes in the roof and animals coming and going, raccoons, and so there are issues here. And I have to say that a lot of cities are having abandoned house discussions and trying to come up with solutions. And we have some here that we need to be able to deal with and not spend 3 years trying to take that property and remove that dwelling. There are some that are just that bad. So thank you. Thank you for coming this evening. I call Phil Anderson. I have asked him for years to form a good landlords association. I think it would be a good thing.
I'll just add to everybody's comments that we appreciate everybody coming. This is an important issue and needs to be discussed. And something needs to happen. When we passed this in 2017, I think all of us were fairly optimistic that with a strong education component, we could make some real progress. The other thing that has happened, as everybody realizes, is the occupancy rate of our rental houses has gone down quite a bit. Now, what that meant to some of us was, well, that will automatically increase competition. So the more vacancy signs you see, the more you would hope some landlords would be motivated to fix up their places. Unfortunately, a lot of these older properties are fully owned. That is, there's no mortgage and there's not much motivation beyond the payment of taxes, perhaps, to do anything inside that house. One of the other things that we were hoping to do is that we would catch the students or the parents prior to their arrival at KSU and have some kind of an ability to steer them into appropriate housing by making wise choices. And all of us, I think, have been through this as young people trying to make wise choices admit that we would like everybody to be self-sufficient, but in some cases there's some help needed. We'd also hope to have a social media campaign, as was mentioned before. this is a very powerful way for individuals to talk about housing that they find unsatisfactory. And it's, if I remember right, when we discussed this with KSU, there's some legal ramifications to how this might work. And I think those same legal ramifications attach to the city as well. So we have to be a little bit careful there, but it does not stop individuals, college students, military personnel, or so on, from having that kind of a discussion online. And I think social media can be very powerful. So beyond some of these structural issues, we have some other things that we need to address to motivate behaviors. I understand the pressure on a young person when they hesitate to call about a code violation because of the threat to lose your deposit or the pain of having to move mid-semester, pay another first month's rent, and things like that. And the one that I'm really struggling with is how you motivate a poor landlord's behavior. You know, one of the things that has been mentioned over and over is when you start a program of inspection or something akin to that, that then predicates people to worry about their properties. So at least it is a precursor to maybe some positive change. The program itself, I think we ought to entertain that. And, you know, we have to get all the partners here huddled up together. We've got great teamwork always with Kansas State University. We've got teamwork with Fort Riley, and obviously they're slightly different. My own experience is when we move people in and out of on-post housing, they had about at least 2 weeks in between tenants simply because we required that the engineers or a contractor go in there and make sure everything was up to snuff. So at least every 2 years, these things got looked at. That is very, very difficult for a city to do. I'd say almost impossible just because of the expense. But we have to find some middle ground here. Fort Riley also has an off-post housing office, relatively fully staffed. And that was one of the things we were hopeful about at Kansas State, is that we would get a lot more heft inside that office to help the city sort out some of these issues. So there's a lot of things that are possibilities here, and I think with great teamwork we can arrive at something that will get us to move forward. And again, I thought that in 2017 we had quite a set to, if you will, between sides that we didn't need to have. But we arrived at a solution that it seemed to be okay with everybody, at least for the time being. That doesn't mean it's good for all time. So appreciate everybody coming and giving us some ideas and some background on the issue. And I think we can take it up and make some progress here.
So I do want to ask a question and to the mayor and city manager. So what, in terms of direction that you just heard, what did you just hear from us?
So I basically heard there's a desire to move forward to strengthen the program that we have, specifically trying to do some significant education, possibly look at this certification program, teaming with K-State, Fort Riley, and other partners to market the best and engaging our landlords to improve housing. I didn't hear a majority that wanted to tackle. I only heard one person that said that we want to go like Lawrence.
Okay, so I want to make that clear. Is that how the rest of you feel? Because if it is, I want to make clear to the audience that rental inspections just died without even a vote.
Yeah, well, I've always made clear I don't want to go back to rental inspection. No. I mean, I think everybody knows that.
When everybody in the room knows where me and you are on this position.
Okay. So we got that cleared up.
I wouldn't rule out an inspection program. I'm just I just teed up the idea of getting together to sort it out. So if we want to look at the Lawrence program or somebody else, to see its puts and takes, that's fine with me.
I think that's a strong statement to make. I think this is how we usually start our process. We don't say, let's go full force with a Lawrence program or something, but that's the direction we're going to see how we can make it even better. Because at that point, we do discuss fees and staffing and who's at the table and everything else. This is not just the people that are here that need to be at that table. It's going to take a different task force and committee where you have fixed income people that are living off of Social Security. What does inspections look to them? You need to have race at the table. You need to have young and older populations, families. The young woman that came with her child, she makes a very strong argument. You need to have all of them at the table to see what rental inspection looks like for them as well. So unless we can agree on that simple platform, we can't just say we are for or against something.
That's
a longer discussion. But
Ron just said he was only going to put city staff time into looking at strengthening education. I agree that I don't want to our next meeting to vote on a Lawrence ordinance. I think that we have to probably have a whole nother discussion about the tenets of what an inspection would look like. But that's not the direction that Ron just received.
He said certification. Certification to me implies some kind of standards and how we're going to get to what does certification look like.
I really only heard Wynn say the word certification.
Ron just. Ron said
I know it. Ron did, but I didn't hear a majority.
I didn't disagree with
I'm
it,
not saying we might not go there. I'm just saying as I counted. but I am also interested in. I think we have to do something more than we have been doing, and I don't intend to spend the next 2 years studying anymore. We know what we need in this community, and we need to move forward. And I am eager, I don't see why not, to look at the Lawrence Ordinance. I think it is our former ordinance here that was eliminated, and so I'm not afraid to look at it.
So I appreciate you generating additional discussion. I think that's helpful, and that so what I'm hearing is we want to start a process to engage folks and start looking at what we have and how we can improve that process. Which will take some time, but that's something obviously we've spent some time on some other provisions like the massage ordinance that's coming. So a similar process to engage stakeholders for improving what we have. And there's been a lot of suggestions thrown out that I'm sure there'll be more.
Okay.
I'd just like to say to you who have come this evening, we have done this before, and in the end, the landlords come in at the last minute and just blow it up. So it's great, but this is a one-sided meeting tonight, and those landlords have money and influence in this community. So you're going to have to keep up your advocacy.
Yeah, I want to make a comment about that, because I felt like the meeting was sort of disingenuous when I looked at the agenda, because I knew we were going to talk about rental inspection, but what was put out there, it said we were going to review the current program. Didn't say we were going to have a lengthy program about rental inspection. The agenda item was review the rental registration program. So I think there's a little bit of lack of transparency. That may be why you don't have anybody from the other side here tonight.
I would agree, and that's why I get upset about how we introduce legislation in our briefing sessions and what we just did up here. It is very untransparent about how you take a proposal and make it into a law. I mean, so yeah, no, I totally agree with you, but that's why I'm always barking about how we operate briefing sessions. I brought up to you all in the briefing sessions that I wanted to talk about rental inspections, and we came out of that like, let's get halfway and do rental registration. We all knew what we were going to talk about that night, but our process wasn't as transparent as it should be. So no, I agree with you on that as well.
Well, I think, you know, as Ron described the focus, it shouldn't be that our intent is to now investigate rental inspection program. It should be, let's take what we got, see if we can move it someplace else. And as I said, a certification program wouldn't incur some inspection, but it wouldn't look like Lawrence's program at all. And I'm still convinced the Lawrence program is against the law. I'd like the legal guys to to fish into that as we're looking at it, because I think we're going to wind up in court if we pass another rental inspection thing based on that Kansas law.
Because I'm just saying, because we didn't vote on anything or give clear direction, I still like, I mean, truly, just I'm just afraid 3 or 4 months from now that city staff's going to come back and say, we invested all of this time into how we could do education, improve education, and we spent just a little bit of time on this inspection part, and it's really not getting to the end game. It's, I mean, at least to me, my proposal was, can we discuss rental inspections? Period. That's what I hope we move forward and we start having task force around those and bring people into the room to discuss what a rental inspection would look like. I realize maybe there could be the second parallel of education, and maybe those go hand in hand, but I want to make that clear, because I think a lot of people in this room and a lot of people in our community are going to be very disappointed if that's what's come back three or four months from now. And one last thing that I want to say, because Wynn mentioned it, and this is what I fear. The members of the landlord community in Manhattan did play a very large role in the state law getting passed. So that should illustrate to you the political power, the political dichotomy that lives in Manhattan between landlords and renters. And so I just want to make it very clear that I'm up here trying to advocate moving things forward. If we put a rental inspection on the ballot tomorrow, it would pass. I'm certain of it. So we should be talking about rental inspections as well as education components and how we can increase those at the same time.
I'd like to mention, too, that this was on our agenda as a work session item on January 22nd, and we had a snowstorm. So this is really the first opportunity we have had to talk about rentals and Jared's proposals. So this is kind of pent up energy also. And so it's not that we, so far, I think, I'm glad we're able to have this discussion, and we'll need to have more, obviously.
Okay, there being no further discussion, we will adjourn. Thank you very much.